Hi there, and welcome to the 7th class of the Archimedes Academy by IMSystems. I'm really looking forward to present to you this lecture, and I hope you do too. Because today I'm finally going to answer the burning question I expect you guys all have. How does the Archimedes Drive work? Well, to explain this to you, you need to understand the principles of the planetary traction drive and the Wolfrom drive. If you have never heard of these or don't know a lot about their advantages and disadvantages, I advise you to first watch the previous two lectures where these drives are explained. And for the people who have watched it or want a quick refresher, I'm now summarizing some of the things discussed over there. A planetary traction drive is a drive that doesn't use gear teeth that mesh with each other, but uses traction with rollers to transmit torque. A Wolfram drive is a type of compound drive which uses an extra layer to create a higher gear ratio by having planets that have an extra layer with a different diameter and different amount of teeth. So if we take these, let's go over the advantages and disadvantages first, because that helps you understand the Archimedes drive and why it is so good a lot better. A planetary traction drive has the following disadvantages. First of all, there's the low reduction ratio, because that's inherent to planetary drives. And then afterwards, I have shown you an example of the inefficient drive. They try to increase the gear ratio and increase life by adding an extra layer of rollers around it, and also a device at the end to control the normal force that adjusts it to the required torque. But because of that, it became a very complex mechanism and therefore expensive, and it never took off. Some other people thought of a way to just take a standard planetary drive, but just make the planet loose hollow and use traction. But as you may remember, you always need an input, an output, and a ground. And in a standard planetary drive, you only have three types of components: the sun wheel, the annulus, and the planet wheels. And therefore, you need to get an access through these planets that's stable. And that's very hard, because if they're squeezed in, they get X-shaped and constantly deform all the time. Then, and if we take only that last one into account, so with the hollow wheels, these are the only two disadvantages that remain. And those are important for the Archimedes drive. Then, the advantages. There are plenty. Because first of all, there's the high efficiency, because the gear teeth don't need to match with each other. It just rolls. And because of the high efficiency, there's also low noise and a high maximum speed, because the lubricant burns or gets overheated way less easy. Then there's the high precision with lack of backlash that gear teeth have, but rolling elements don't. If it stops moving, it just stops moving. And the planet wheels are hollow, so it is lightweight. And there's a controlled end of life, because when gear teeth get, they break, or if they wear, they sometimes lock, then a robot stops working, and an assembly line may need to shut down until it is replaced. But with traction, you will see that the surface deteriorates over time, and at a certain moment, performance gets less. But then you can still schedule maintenance in a few weeks from now to replace or repair the component. Then the Wolfram drive. It also has two disadvantages. The first one is the lack of efficiency, because in all those layers and all these places where the gears meet each other, there's always efficiency losses. And, well, it's also quite complex to get that all together in all these layers. And that's also expensive. But also, if you want to get some efficiency, you need to work with very good tolerances. And that also adds to the cost. But still, there are some niche applications where they are still used nowadays. And that is because of these advantages. First, there's the high reduction ratio. It can get very big. And normally, to achieve that, you would need to stack drives on top of each other, so their gear ratios multiply. Now you can get it all in one compact package. And compact also means that there is a high torque density. And now we go to the next step. And I guess that's what was going on in the mind of the inventor, Jack Scorch, the CEO of IMSystems, when he invented the Archimedes drive. I think he thought, what if we take a traction from this drive and combine it with the multiple layers for the Wolfram principle? Then we get an Archimedes drive. And before I go into why it is so good, I first want to teach you some terminology. First, I go over Flexroller and why the Archimedes drive is called an Archimedes drive. Well, the Flexroller is just another name we give to our planet wheels. The planet wheels are hollow and round for the rolling. That's the traction component, but they are also have the Wolfram or compound principle in them with the multiple layers. And we have made various ones, sometimes with only two steps, sometimes a more symmetrical variation. And this is the core of our very first patent. And they are so thin-walled that they can be squeezed in a little bit. Then, to understand the Archimedes drive principle, I go back to the last lecture, where we discussed that with a Wolfram drive, you have two layers with two sum wheels and two analytes. And we assign functions to it. So an input sum wheel in the same layer, a ground analyst, and in the second layer, there's the output analyst, which means the three most important functions are covered. And, well, there's an idle sum wheel to keep everything in place. And the planet wheels don't actually need one of those functions. They only function as the lever between the components. So if you put that into a formula to calculate the gear ratio, I recently presented that there's this lever effect over here with the ground analyst fixated to the world. And then if the input sum wheel drives in this direction, then the output analyst will go in that direction. And if you want to go to these higher gear ratios, you can do that. This is the formula for the Wolfram part of the gear ratio. You can do that by increasing what's on top of the fraction or decreasing what's at the bottom. Well, if you look on top, you see the diameter of the output analyst and the diameter of the small planet. Well, we can increase them, but up to a certain limit, because at a certain moment, the drive just gets bigger and heavier, and then you lose the torque density. So let's look at the bottom. Well, the diameter of the input sum can be shrunk, but also to a certain limit. And it also needs to be able to handle torque. So you can't make it too thin. Well, then there's the step size. That's this part over here. And where Wolfram drives with gears are limited by a difference of one tooth more on the output analyst than the input, the ground analyst. We don't have that limit. We can say, let's make a lever and a diameter difference of 1 micrometer. Well, you can imagine if you put in a value of 1 micrometer in here, that the gear ratio gets huge. We've actually done so already with one drive in lab conditions that achieved a gear ratio of 10,000 to 1. But Jack already realized this right when he invented it. And he called it the Archimedes drive because it was Archimedes who once said, give me a lever long enough and a fulcrum on which to place it, and I shall move the world. So that's the history behind the Archimedes drive. But history is nice if you have advantages that work in the real world. So let's go back to the advantages and disadvantages of the two drive types this is made of. And look for each of them, what remains and what's no longer in place. So let's look at the disadvantages of the planetary traction drive. No stable access to the planets. That was an issue. But if you look back over here, it's no longer required because the functions are performed by these three components. So, so this is no longer an issue. And then the low reduction ratio. Well, I just explained to you how the Wolfram principle increases it by a lot. So that's also not an issue anymore. Then the advantages. It still rolls instead of hooking into each other. So that still means the high efficiency, which on its turn means that there is low noise and a high maximum speed. Also, there is still no backlash with rolling. So still that very high precision. The wheels are still hollow, which is more lightweight than massive planet wheels. And there is the controlled end of life because the main failure mode is still the rolling surface deteriorating. Then the Wolfram drive. The disadvantage of low efficiency, that was because on all these layers you needed to stack these gears together, needed to mesh perfectly. But we don't have that issue anymore. We can just take a few cylinders, squeeze another cylinder in between. It's easy and it also means less complexity. But it also means an increase in efficiency because it just rolls. And also, cylinders are way cheaper to produce than gears. So it also means we can be less expensive. And then the advantages, are those still in place? Well, the high reduction ratio I already explained to you. But still, we can achieve that in one stage. So it is still compact. And with compactness comes the torque density, which is also good. So taking this all together, these two drives combined, meant that the big disadvantages were eliminated. Well, all the advantages remain. And when I years ago realized that this was the case, I was flabbergasted. Wow, this is such a great invention. And that's why I just decided to start working on this with Jack. And I hope you are just as fascinated by me about his work and principle and where it leads to. In the next class, I will dive deeper into how, what the performance is. And I hope you really enjoyed it and understand it now. Yeah, I hope to see you in the next lecture. And if you have any questions or comments, drop them in the comment. Drop them below, and I will try to answer as soon as possible. Bye.